morning. Good morning, everyone. Happy Monday. I hope you're having an absolutely fantastic day. All right, my friends. So I know that the last couple of weeks we've gone through quite a few different things, right? We did the overall kind of economic update 3 weeks ago. And then we obviously there was a lot going on with the Silicon Valley Bank collapse. So we spent a lot of time on that 2 weeks ago. And last week we went over some of the commercial and luxury trends, as well as some of the NAR data just about the profile of a buyer and seller. And so I think those are great to kind of go over from a presentation style. If you're getting your buyer consultation or your listing consultation prepared, or if you were actually in Friday's class, on Friday, we talked a lot about this idea of our ideal customer avatar, right? And so last week, what we went over from an information perspective, I think is really good to kind of apply to this idea of who is our ideal customer. But today, what we're going to go through, so we're going to spend some time, of course, going over Los Angeles County, Orange County, Riverside, and San Bernardino, kind of back to our month over month and year over year data that we tend to go over on a regular basis. So we're going to revisit that for the four counties. And then I actually want to talk a little bit about the Fed meeting that happened last week. There's some things that were a little bit surprising with this last Fed meeting. And so I think it's important for us to kind of review that. Because it turned out a little differently than was anticipated, was widely anticipated. And we're going to talk a little bit about why that happened, as well as some of the concerns kind of moving forward on the market, but also what is going to be incredibly important for us when we are talking to our clients around what their opportunity is right now. So just want to kind of pre-frame that. Let's go ahead and jump right in. As always, my friends, my TCPA disclaimer, please make sure that whatever phone calls, text messages you are sending, you are doing so in a TCPA compliant way. All right, moving it right along, let's look at Los Angeles County. So earlier this month, we had gone over the change from January to February. Right now, what we're going to be looking at is the 1st through the 26th of the month through the 1st through the 26th of March. A couple caveats that I want to give you because I think it's important as we look at these trends to see just some of the item, kind of put the lens here, right? We know that when we looked at February, we are very close to a full month of data when we look at the 1st through the 26th because there was only 28 days in February. Whereas here in March, we still have quite a few more days to kind of close out the end of the month. So that may impact some of the numbers once we look at month end. So always take that into consideration, a shorter month versus a longer month, especially when we're looking at February versus March. Also, as we start seeing some of the trends that generally occur with seasonality, we know that in accordance with a more normal seasonality, we start to see a kind of increases usually in accordance with normal seasonality in as we get closer and closer to the second quarter of the year, right? So January, February, March, we tend to see some of that trend line going up. So you can see towards the beginning of 2022, where again, we were coming off of a pandemic year. So there's a little bit of that skew that came from the skewed seasonality that we experienced during the COVID-19 kind of really middle of that pandemic. We can still see that the number of properties for sale started to see a little growth from January, February, March, and then waited to April, May, June, July, right? Continuing up, which is a trend that usually occurs in accordance with seasonality. That was not the case when we look at January to February, right? And so when we start looking at this data, the 1st through the 26th, or the 1st of the 26th, and this number is down 2.7% in terms of the number of properties for sale, that is not kind of in alignment with our normal seasonality. It is significantly more than what was on the market last year, up 31%, but just not in aligned with normal seasonality trends. And so I think that's important as the lens that we look at this information through. When we look at the number of properties sold, so again, January through February of last year saw a little bit of a dip and then a big increase in March. Again, shorter month, right? Shorter month in February. But we actually saw a little bit of growth from January to February. And the number of properties sold is still trending up when we look at the month over month. So from last month to now, this is up 23.4%. However, it is down significantly from where we were a year ago, down 39.5%. We look at the number of new listings on the market. So this has really gone against our normal seasonality here, where we have seen a little bit more of a flattening or a balance increase here from January to February. We saw a decline in February. Number of new listings still continuing that trend downward in March, down 7.3%, down 41.8% year over year. So again, it's always important to kind of inspect what we expect here. When we start thinking about this idea of new listings coming on the market, we know that right now, one of the biggest objections that we tend to see on our sellers is this idea of, am I going to trade my low interest rate for a higher interest rate, right? Am I going to trade this kind of low payment for this higher payment? And we know that there's a big percentage of our buyers that are also potential sellers. So if they choose to then not sell, well, that's tying up a couple transactions that otherwise may have come on the market right there with the inventory. So seeing new listings go down, not kind of in accordance with our normal seasonality trends right now, seeing that continue to go down as we kind of see these continued interest rates. In reality, what's incredibly important is that we look for those buyers and sellers that are moving or selling or buying out of necessity, right? Out of life cycles and not economic cycles. So what do I mean by that? We know that people will still, right, sell when certain things happen in their lives. So as an example, a probate is an example of that. Somebody passes away, they're not timing when that happens in accordance with where the market's at, right? It's a fact of life that that happens. And so that is a type of sale, affidavit of death being kind of the preliminary to probate. Divorces, right? Especially right now, usually generally with a divorce type scenario, they use two incomes to make a particular purchase. So as they're separating those incomes, the necessity to sell, it becomes a necessity, not an option, right? And so that is a time that somebody must sell. Notice of defaults is going to be another aspect of that. When somebody is kind of behind on their mortgage payments and they're not able to catch up, when somebody gets laid off, that's going to be another aspect of a necessity, something that precipitates a necessity to sell. If somebody's relocating out of state, right? So I want you to think through that, because as we see the number of new listings go down, one of the things that I always think is so important to think about is, while the opportunity that exists may be less, it does not mean that your opportunity is less. I want to say that again, right? Just because the number of opportunities that exist may be less, it does not mean that your opportunity is less. That is a choice that we make, but it also means that our message, our marketing message, must match who we're marketing to, right? It must match the moment that we're in. It must match the market that we're in. We call that market of the moment, right? And so yes, new listings are down. And yet we want to look at, okay, if the new listings are down right now, where is the actual opportunity at? On the flip side, of those that are buying, right? Of those that are buying, somebody gets married, somebody has a baby, somebody is going away to school and wants to buy additional property there. Investors that are coming back right now. We've definitely seen an uptick in two categories. We've seen a significant uptick in land sales right now. And we've also seen a significant uptick in manufactured homes. Maybe that's not something that you've considered before or included any marketing around. And maybe that's a message that you should be sharing right now that is going to increase affordability for the clientele. Talk to Downey Capital. They have a lot of programs around that they've been looking into as well. If you haven't looked at this yet, one of the other programs that they mentioned that I thought was really nice to look at, considering affordability is such a big issue right now, was that 1% down program that they've been talking about. So definitely talk to them on that. Okay, so kind of gives you the trend line here on new listings. What about our pendants, right? We tend to see an uptick of pendants. We kind of saw that return to a more normalized seasonality last year, where we saw that big kind of growth here in March before we started to see the decline as interest rates started to go up. We saw a little bit of growth here from January to February, and yet month to date down 3.9%. Month to date down 37.7% from this same point a year ago. Oh, sorry guys. There we go. Average active price. When we look at our pricing here, now here's a different trend, right? I always think this is really interesting. We see the number of new listings go down, right? I'm going to go back really quickly. We saw pendants go down, but we are seeing the sold number go up a little bit. And so when we start looking at where we're at with price, we've seen an increase here in the average active price. We kind of fell to the lowest rate here in October, right over here, right? Was the lowest rate that we'd been at when it comes to the average active price, all the way back up here as we come into February. So what happens, right? What happens here? We're definitely seeing a lot of negotiation, right? Properties that are not necessarily, they're listed for a certain price, but we're seeing a lot of that negotiation during the transaction. And so sometimes people will pad that active price a little bit in order to have room for negotiation, right? So you want to have that kind of clarity with clients. We have also seen some growth in demand. So as we've seen fluctuation with interest rates, right, we saw this kind of dip as the interest rate first went up, because it went up fairly significantly, fairly quickly, right? And so we saw a lot of people get a little nervous and take their feet out of the water. And then we started seeing people kind of toe the line a little bit. They started watching what was going on and realizing that the rates were kind of continuing to go up instead of experiencing a decline. And so now as people started getting a little bit more comfortable with that concept, they start putting their foot back in the water, right? And so we saw an increase in the number of transactions that were happening. We saw kind of buyers return to the market. That's going to be big for us to look at, especially considering that this last Fed meeting, we did not see a decline or a no change in the rate. We actually saw it go up, right? And so I think that was really interesting, especially right now. But that's part of why we're seeing this average active price go up. We're also seeing an increase in that average sold price. So up 6% month over month from last month, down from last year, 0.5%. That's still fairly balanced here. We look at our absorption rate. We see this amount of inventory is continuing to decline, down 29% month over month. We look at our average days on market. Average days on market are down 40 days on market, right? Down 9.1% over 1 month. We saw that's a pretty significant decline over a 1 month period of time. I know you guys are seeing it as well, right? We're seeing more multiple offer scenarios coming back, not everywhere, but we are seeing that in certain instances as well. And then this sold versus original list price, a little bit of an increase, but again, remember our average active price is also going up here, right? Our average active price here is also going up. So that spread is a little bit different here. All right, looking at Orange County, we look at the number of properties for sale month over month, down 2.1%. That's up significantly from a year ago, up 45.4%. We look at the number of properties sold. We saw an increase from January to February. We're seeing an increase thus far in March of 18.7%, still down significantly from where we were a year ago, down 40.2%. We start looking at our new listings. So another similar, right? This is what we would consider starting to become a trend, because it's happening in LA County. It's happened in Orange County, where we're seeing that dip in the amount of new listings that are coming on the market. Down 12.5% and down a little under 50% year over year. We look at our properties pending, down 3.4%, and down 40.8% year over year. One of the other things that I'd say is really important, if you are taking listings and they are staying on the market a bit longer, we need to be setting that expectation with our clients right now, right? We need to be setting the expectation with our clients. We're not in the same market we were a year ago. We're not in that market where we put the property on the market and it just immediately sells, right? We can't just do what we consider, what I used to joke and call it the three P's of real estate, right? Somebody puts it on the MLS, puts a sign in the yard, and then they go pray. We actually need to be promoting that listing through different marketing avenues, right? Doing advertisements, doing our open houses. We want to be prospecting for new buyers on that property. And we want to make sure that we're price watching on that property as well. That's going to be a really big kind of opportunity. If you're taking those listings, especially in a market where we're starting to see that decline in new listings across the board, we want to ensure that we are doing everything we can to get the listings that we do have sold, that we're talking through this kind of negotiation as well. The other thing that happens, there are lowball offers that are coming in, right? There are absolutely lowball offers that are coming in. Now, last year, if your clients got a lowball offer and they got mad and they decided, well, we don't even want to answer that offer. We don't even want to work with that particular person, right? Because they get offended at the low offer, another offer would come. That's not always the case right now. And so it really is our job to kind of educate our clients about not necessarily becoming or taking it so personal when there's a lower offer, and simply countering, right? And simply countering and seeing what they're able to get. We saw that on another property that we had where they got an offer. The clients did not want to even respond to it. They were so offended. And yet they weren't really getting much else on the property. And the agent basically encouraged them to respond, to counter to that offer. And they were able to get to a price that they could feel good about and move forward with. And they ended up closing on the deal. So that's going to be important for us to kind of navigate that conversation with our clients. The other thing I want to note that I just have to point out, right, is while we see the number of new listings decrease across the board, and we're seeing this in LA, Orange County, I'm sure we're going to see it in some of the other counties as well. I'm just proud to report that as an office, our listings are actually up 50%. So we are definitely bucking this trend line so far. So that's definitely a testament to all of your work, but also important to kind of take advantage to move that inventory as well. We look at the Orange County pricing trends, average active price up 4.6%, down year over year, down 9.4%. So again, we're still seeing that kind of increase in the active price. And then that average sold price is also up month over month, up 7.1%, but down from a year ago. So down about 7.8% from this same time period a year ago. We look at our absorption rates, sticking to some of the trends that we're seeing, especially with the number of new listings kind of being a little bit low across the board here. The amount of inventory available is less than 2 months, has gone down to about 1.4 months of available inventory here. Last but not least, our days on market down. We've dropped below the 40-day mark, down to 38 days on market here in Orange County, and no change on that sold versus original list price. All right, let's look at our Riverside County trends. So starting to move into our lower price point counties, we see the number of properties for sale has also dropped down 3.9% month over month, up 94.9% from last year. And then we look at the number of properties sold, that is up 9.8%, but down significantly from a year ago. We look at our inventory trends, right? We look at our inventory trends. This number of new listings is down 5.6%. Right? So third county, where we're seeing that trend continue, where the listings are declining, not in accordance with our traditional seasonality. And yet our pendants are up 9.5%. We look at our pricing trends, average active price up 2.6%. So another area where we're continuing to see that increase in that average active price, And then that average sold price month over month, pretty balanced, right? Pretty balanced here at 0.5%, but down 8.1% from a year ago. So important here, we've definitely seen drops from a year ago, but we look at that month over month data, we're starting to see a little bit of that increase happening. And the last but not least, our absorption rates here in Riverside County continuing to drop down 21.7% to 2.1 months of inventory. All right, this average days on market, we're still above 50 days here in Riverside County, but it's about 52 days on market, a slight decline. So that's holding steady across the three counties so far. And that sold versus original list price is seeing a little bit of a trend upward. But remember that active price has also gone up, right? That active price has also gone up. All right, last but not least, looking at San Bernardino County, moving into our lowest price point area, we look at the number of properties for sale. We've seen a decline of 7.9% month over month. We look at the number of properties sold, that is up 7.4% month over month. We'll probably continue to see a little bit of that trend there. And then when we look at it a year ago, up number of properties for sale, up 44.4%. Number of properties sold down 46.9, almost 47. New listings, sticking to the trend downward here, although we saw a little bit more fluctuation last year as well than we had in some of the other counties, but we did see an increase last year in March, which again kind of correlates to normal seasonality. That is not the case so far month to date. We're seeing our new listings are down 41.1%. And then the number of properties pending is down 2.6%. This is also a little bit different than we're seeing in the other counties, right? We saw the properties pending actually has gone up in LA County, in Orange County, and in Riverside County. But here in San Bernardino County, where we've gone into a little bit of our lowest price point, we're actually seeing the number of properties pending has experienced a little bit of a decline month over month as the anomaly here. That's important to pay attention to, right? That's always, we always want to inspect what we expect, but that's going to be important to look at because it's different from what we're seeing in the other counties. When we look at our pricing trends, average active price experiencing a little bit of an increase, 0.7%. That's pretty balanced here. And then the average sold price up 3.8%. Both are down from a year ago. So this is a pretty consistent trend we've seen across all four counties. We look at our absorption rates, similar to what we're seeing, a decrease in the 20s, 21.6%. We continue to see the amount of inventory that is available go down, right? Let me go back to this really quickly. I think part of the reason that this is so important for us to look at is that especially as we start seeing some of these changes in interest rates and we start seeing some of the changes in the market, it is very easy if we're not inspecting what we expect to make an assumption like I've heard it said where people are like, oh, we're in a buyer's market. And maybe in some parts of the country, we are, right? And maybe in some parts of the country, we are, but not in the counties that we serve. At least not if we are going by traditional technical definition, where 1 to 5 months of inventory is considered a quote unquote seller's market, where 5 to 7 months of inventory is a balanced market and 7+ months of inventory is a buyer's market, right? What would need now, I think sometimes when we think of, oh, are we in a buyer's market? Are we a seller's market? We're thinking, oh, well, there's less buyers on the market. Well, there's also less inventory in some cases on the market, right? And being in a buyer or seller's market has everything to do with supply and demand. When there is extensive supply, such that it is more than meets the demand, right? Such that it is more than meets the demand, then the prices have to adjust for that, right? When we have a little bit of supply, which right now, we have 2.5 months of supply here in San Bernardino County, meaning that the amount of available inventory on the market right now, based on the current demand, how many closed sales there are on a monthly basis right now, that the current supply of inventory would last 2.5 months before it would be gone to service the current demand in the market right now. Now, obviously demand changes, right? And so supply changes. But right now in all four counties, our inventory is still low, right? It's still in no places is it even getting close to this 5 months of available inventory. The challenge that we're having right now is not necessarily a issue of, hey, there's too much supply. The challenge right now is while the demand exists, there's a bigger affordability gap, right? And so the buyers that are able to kind of meet the supply that's currently available, they have definitely a higher payment, right? In a lot of cases due to the interest rate. And so there's just a higher barrier to entry. Does not mean there's not enough buyers that are out there to meet the supply, because clearly we have absorption rate of 2.5 months of inventory. And that's fairly consistent across all four counties right now, right? And so it's important we hear what the news is telling us and what's out in the world and what people are talking about. But we can't just depend on that. We have to be able to look at the data and see what that actually supports, because what it tells me is that there are still buyers out there that are actively buying. The only challenge that you have is you have to go out and find more clients that are not just ready and willing, but that are able to transact business, right? And that it might take a little bit more activity, but they are definitely out there, because we definitely are still in below 3 months of inventory across all four counties here, okay? And then days on market, no change. 55 days on market is about the average right now in San Bernardino County. And then sold versus original list price, up 1.1%. All right. So this is where we get through kind of some of the regular market information. And then we're going to go through a little bit more here as it relates to what's been going on with Silicon Valley. Let me come right over here. So I know some of you were on the Silicon Valley call that we did 2 weeks ago. I think it's important to kind of just give a little bit of an overview here. I think it's important for us to have an understanding of what is happening in the market right now, and some of the risk, some of the risk in the market. When we looked at what happened with the Silicon Valley Bank collapse, essentially, and I've talked about this before, is the bonds, right? Savings bonds have an inverse relationship with the rates, right? And so when we came out of that weekend of SVG, what had ended up happening is that you have a bank, Silicon Valley, that was essentially overexposed in two areas. One, they work with a lot of startups, right? And that's going to be one element where they had some overexposure. The second area they had overexposure in was they had a lot of bonds. And so these bonds, if they have an inverse relationship with the rates, that means that as the rates go up, the value of the bonds goes down. Now, if you can keep the bonds long enough, right? If you can keep the bonds long enough such that you can wait out until the rates decline again, and see that value of the bonds grow, then you're in a good position. The problem is that with banks, you have your what we call your short-term liability. So if we were looking at a profit and loss statement, you have your assets and your liabilities, and you have your different income sources, et cetera. Now, this money that was in the bonds is tied up in the bonds, meaning that that is no longer liquid cash flow that you have as a bank. That's also how banks make money, right? They go and we put our funds into the bank, and they take those funds and a portion of them they invest so that they can make a return on those investments. And then we get a very small percentage of that return if we have like a savings account or something, right? But they're actually making the majority of that money. Now, in the case with Silicon Valley, they were in a position where too much of their funds was non-liquid. They didn't have immediate access to that. And so when the companies that bank with them came, and a lot in the tech sector, right, came and now are withdrawing money because those companies have their own short-term liabilities, like making payroll, right? Or business expenses, or those, all those different things that happens with the bank. When they go and they're now withdrawing their money, well, now there's a concern if there's not enough liquid capital to meet the demand of the withdrawals. And then there was a lot of concern that happened that weekend. Obviously, there was a lot of news that happened around this that spewed fear, which meant more and more people went to go withdraw money from the bank and withdraw their funds, such that SVG did no longer had the liquid capital to meet the demand of those withdrawals. Now, FDIC insures your funds that you put into a bank up to $250K, right, per essentially per your social security number or per your EIN number if you have your business in a banking account. That's per institution that you have funds in. And so there's a certain amount that was insured. The government then went and said, okay, hey, we're not gonna save the bank, but we are going to make sure that anybody that had their funds there is going to be able to get access to their funds. And so they kind of went a little bit higher than the insurance would normally cover with FDIC to be able to support the companies that had their funds in the bank. That's the first part, right? And so coming into that, and even myself, I considered that when we looked at the Fed meeting that happened last week, that this kind of continued increase of the interest rate, which is really geared as a tool to help stop inflation, that perhaps we would see that they did not increase the rate again, but they did, right? But they did. So really interesting to kind of see this happening right now, because we here have this bank that's collapsed and then another bank that followed, which was, I want to say, was Signature, that had a lot of money in crypto. Don't quote me on the bank name. There was two that I was looking at, so I might have conflated them. But one of them that was highly overexposed in the crypto market, that also experienced a bank run and also collapsed, right? And so those both happened the same weekend. We saw that going on. With the Fed meeting, considering that the interest rate continuing to rise up is then affecting the bonds, the concern was that if they continue to raise the interest rates, well, would that affect other banks? And so it's interesting because I've been listening to a lot of economists talk. I've been kind of just listening to a lot of people in the financial industries discuss what happened. Considering that what the assumption was is that the Federal Reserve was going to meet and say, hey, we're not going to raise the rates right now, because why don't we take a wait and see approach and just wait a month, right? Just wait a month to see if the impact has a sort of latency. And so what I mean is everything kind of works almost like dominoes, right? You hit one domino and it's going to hit the next domino, and these things have a continued impact. And so the idea that a lot of economists were suggesting was that, you know, some of the impacts that we're seeing right now could have a latency period, and it would be in the Federal Reserve's best interest to kind of wait and see for a month to see what the continued impact is going to be of this recent bank collapse before they continue to raise the rates. But that did not happen, right? They have been tightening the kind of funds target rate since March of 2022. And so despite the fact that, you know, this recent bank collapse happened, they kind of had a couple options. They could raise the rates to sustain this fight against high inflation. They could hit pause to give the market space to kind of cope with the fallout from the banking collapse. And what they decided to do instead was to continue to raise the rates. And so we saw that happen this past kind of month. What they're saying is that what they believe is that the U.S. banking system is sound and resilient, and that these kind of recent developments are likely to result kind of in tighter credit conditions, but also that it's important to kind of really watch what is happening with the inflation market. And so that's kind of what we saw. Now, that's one aspect of it. I think the other thing that's going to be really big for us to look at is specifically one of the other areas that is a little bit of a cause for concern is commercial real estate. And so this is where I want to know what's going to be really important on as I've been listening to this and kind of watching with commercial real estate. So I'm going to note, I want to give you some numbers for the Silicon Valley collapse. At the end of 2022, Silicon Valley Bank had about $8.3 billion that was in personal home mortgages, $138 million that was for home equity credit lines. And then on the commercial side, they had $2.6 billion in loans, with 35% of that was in multifamily and 21% in office buildings. The amount that it had increased in exposure to commercial real estate since 2021 was about $90 million, because they had acquired a bank called Boston Private that, I'm sorry, not 90 million, 900 million, because they had acquired a bank called Boston Private that held about 900 million in specifically commercial loans. Now, what's interesting right now in commercial real estate is that you have a lot of loans that are a little bit more short-term. So if we look at the market right now, right? If we look at the market right now, compared to the market a year ago, compared to the market 2 years ago, while we are still seeing lending happen, what we're not seeing as much of is refis, right? Refis. The difference being that on the commercial sector, we have a lot shorter term loans where they are in a position that they are needing to refi, right? Because the time is coming up on their loan. And so that's where this kind of new issue is going to come up with banks that have kind of a high amount of their portfolio in commercial lending. It's something that we're watching, right? It's something that we're watching, because these commercial loans may need to be refinanced, and yet the loan holders may not be able to afford to refinance some of those loans at the current rates. And so it's something that we're going to continue to kind of monitor. I just wanted to catch you up because this March Fed meeting obviously didn't necessarily go the way that most anticipated, since we saw kind of that continued rate hike coming in. And so we're going to continue to kind of watch that and what the impact is going to be. Now, how does that impact you, right? As the agent, what is our role that we play in really being an advisor to our clients? Now, if you did not attend the mortgage hacks class, right? If you did not attend the mortgage hacks class, that is going to be on the calendar in April, right? It will be on the calendar again in April. There is a mortgage hack smart plan that is available for you in the smart plans for command that you can utilize with clients. Our job, right? Our job as agents is to showcase value to our clients about why now could still be a good time to buy for them. What we know is that when we do start seeing any sort of rate declines, it's impacted with a ton of buyers getting back into the market. So I think the statistic is something like every time the rate goes down 1%, 5 million buyers get back in the market. Again, I want you to think about this idea of latency period, right? Is if I'm a buyer that is watching and knows that number, right? I want to be one of the first of the 5 million. I don't want to be the 5 millionth person, because what happens? That means 5 million more buyers that get back on the market. And now we're trying to fight demand, right? The demand of having that many buyers back on the market. Now that's on a national scale, but I want you to kind of understand what that impact is to your clients. And so if you are working with sellers, right now, then what's important is that we really look at what is it going to take to get that home sold quickly. What are some of the things that we can do creatively on how we're messaging for that home? Is your client willing to offer a credit to help either buy down the rate or create more affordability option for the buyers. Are they willing to maybe seller finance, right? Is another kind of scenario to run through. And how might that also potentially benefit them? Now, if you're going to do anything like that, come talk to us because we need to bring in a third party to be able to do that since we are not loan holders ourselves, right? But that's important to look at. Now, if we're working with buyers, right, we want to go through different aspects of affordability and we want to run through some scenarios of rent versus buy, right? Because here's the thing, considering inflation right now, if we're buying, what value does that give me in an inflationary market, right? I want you to think through that, right? Is what value is there to buy in a market that is experiencing inflation? Well, we lock in our cost of living when we purchase a property, right? We lock in our cost of living. If the rates go down, so we get a lot of people that'll say something like this, right? Oh, I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait till the rates go down. Well, if they have the ability to buy right now, why would they not just refinance when the rates go down, right? And still be able to lock in the amount of equity that they gain during that time, right? So there's options that they have to be able to lock in the cost of living right now, knowing that rent goes up year over year, right? And yet you can lock in a payment for 30 years. Why would you not? But, and you get tax benefits. Now, again, we're not a tax advisor, right? But a lot of your clients don't know some of the additional benefits that they can get when they purchase. And so it's up to us to really have some of those conversations with them about the long-term value that they have in owning a home. And as inflation and prices continue to rise, well, their value goes up over time, right? It's why I always think that quote that Gary shares is so interesting, where he says, you know, inflation is the biggest threat to our democracy, right? Because those that have more get more, meaning those that have assets, well, their assets go up in value, and those that have less get less because the cost of living goes up, right? So it's up to us to have those conversations with our clients. The other thing I want to know, and this is just me personally, one of the things that I'm passionate about as well, let me go back because I don't want to go to this yet. One of the things that I'm really passionate about as well is, what about you and your opportunity? Right? What about you and your opportunity? I, especially right now, I think understanding what is happening in the market is one thing, but understanding the process and some of the emotions that your clients go through is also important. And so I encourage you, sit down with Nancy, sit down with Rosie, sit down with Louise, and go through what it's like to do the pre-approval process for yourself, right? For yourself. What would it look like? What would you need, right? How much money would you need as a down payment, right? Look at some of the programs that exist out there, because one, I believe that in the next 4 to 6 years, right? In the next 4 to 6 years, your opportunity is greater than it has ever been to not only be able to help more people, but to grow your own wealth. Now, might be a little bit more work, right? We might need to get a little creative. And we're definitely going to be solving a lot of problems, right? Especially with everything going on in the economy, but your opportunity is greater than it has ever been if you commit to working through it, right? To working through the challenges. So I just wanted to kind of share that lens to kind of look at what's happening in the market, as well as because I want you to have an understanding of it, because this is what your clients are seeing on the news right now, and they need to know what it means for them. And so take advantage of some of that mortgage hacks. Make sure you attend the class in April. I'm going to start keeping that on the calendar. I think it's a really important piece to go through. And we'll go through there. Now, second, so we're not going to cover too much more today, but I did want to remind you, tomorrow is our March team meeting and award ceremony. It's going to be a little bit different. The weather has been crazy, so we didn't want to do outdoors like we did last year. This year, it's going to be at Look Cinemas, which is here about a block away from the office. It's going to be in theater number 8. I encourage you to arrive early. There is limited seating. But we're really looking forward to it for two reasons. Is one, not only are we going to be doing our award ceremony in here, we actually have a panel And what I'm really excited about with this particular panel, this came from our Agent Leadership Council, but what I'm really excited about is one of the things we've been talking about is it's very easy to sometimes get discouraged if we're not yet at the place where we're winning an award, right? And so we want to talk a little bit about not just the things that it takes to, you know, succeed, not just the tips and tricks that are working, but actually what are some of those hardest moments that, especially with some of our associates that are maybe winning awards now, what did it look like when they were starting? What did it look like when things weren't all sunshine and rainbows? What did it look like when things were really, really hard? What does it look like all the million of nights before somebody is dubbed an overnight success, right? Because I don't think that idea of overnight success is really accurate. I don't think that's real, right? I think there's a quote that I love by one of my favorite authors, Sandra Cisneros, and she said, they called me an overnight success. And I thought, well, that was the longest night of my life, right? And so I think that's really important for us to look at sometimes is what does it look like under the hood of somebody's life before they are kind of in achievement mode. And so we'll be talking through that tomorrow. With that being said, I do see a couple questions. Adriana, I will find out more and get back to you on that. Santiago, in terms of if it will be streamed on Zoom, our goal is to stream it. And if we're able to, we will send out a text message with the link beforehand. And I'm just going to be really transparent. It's our first time doing an event at this particular location. The online kind of Zoom and everything, their Wi-Fi is public Wi-Fi. Right. And so what I don't want to say is that, yes, 100% we're going to stream it. And then for whatever reason, their Wi-Fi or everything's not working correctly. So we are going to attempt to stream it, my friends, but we may just end up recording it and posting it later. Tomorrow will be at 3 p.m. at the theater. With that, I hope you all have an absolutely fantastic day. And I will talk to you all soon. Have a good one.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Monica. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Oh.